do the service the way the Jews do it, you know, they were told to do it. We have not been trained. We haven't gone to Hebrew school. We don't understand. Now, I want to dispel something. There's Brother Paul. Praise God. I want to dispel something. That we haven't really started, Brother Paul, so praise God. I'm just sharing my heart. I was sharing with him that if I did an authentic Kol Nidre service, nobody would understand what was going on. First of all, it would be in Hebrew. Second of all, I don't know it myself yet. I have to learn, learning and learning. But also, we have to be schooled. So this is more about what the kind of a, incorporate a few of the things that you would see at a traditional service and teach you what they mean. And then we're going to, in spirit, we're going to go through, like the men are going to stay. I'm very much leaning towards anyone who wants to stay for the shut-in part, just having the men on one side and the women on the other, you know. If you want to stay and pray with us, I'm leaning towards that because we don't have a lot of men that showed up anyway. And so, you know, one of my kids is out of town. The other one is at school. He says he's going to come. Caleb got home from work. He's exhausted. I kept him out half the night, and he got up early and went to work. So this is not compulsory. In my household, they have to come to church on Sunday. They have to come. They can choose. But it kind of breaks my heart they didn't choose to come to church, just like it does with the rest of the congregation, you know, that they don't understand what a beautiful, beautiful celebration this is. It is a celebration of God taking away all of our sins. Amen. What better thing to celebrate than God removing all of our sins, amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So let's go ahead and start the camera. Have you started already?
Yes.
Praise God. All right. Praise God, as I was sharing, that this is the Kol Nidre service, our very first Yom Kippur Eve service. And Yom Kippur started at sundown, which is 6:14. And if we would have been kosher and everything, we wouldn't have any Torahs up here already. And these are just little replicas. Paul has the original ones. They would still be in their ark in the back, all right? They would be in their ark. The menorah would have already been lit. The women would have said the prayer, and they would have lit the menorah. We're not going to light the menorah tonight. But the menorah would have been lit, and we would open up with the Kol Nidre. Now, you have the words to it. And I said, Yom Kippur Eve service. May we enter the solemn service with reverence unto our God. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, Abba, Adonai, the Great One, we just come to you now. We thank you so much for this celebration of the redemption of your people through the blood of Yeshua that you pointed to and you promised about through Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. You told us about this time. And now, Lord, you have brought it about. And we can rejoice in celebrating and observing this eve as your children, Lord. Some of us Jews, some of us grafted in, but all of us part of the one new man through Yeshua HaMashiach. I thank you now in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. How you doing, Brother Kevin?
Ready to go?
We're ready. So ideally, the Kol Nidre should begin shortly before sunset. We're a little bit later. It was at 6:14. The Torah scrolls would have been removed from the ark if we had Torah scrolls. I know someone who does, but I didn't prod him to get them here. Maybe next year it'll be a ritual. I'm hoping by next year you'll have the ark. They might even keep it in the tabernacle. Who knows? The cold hydration begins shortly before sunset. The Torah scrolls are removed from the ark, and it's a great mitzvah to purchase the honor of holding the first Torah scroll. Now, when I go to Chabad, when I go to Torah observances at Kippur, the men and the families, they purchase this honor, usually for their boys, to be able to touch the Torah scroll or carry it in or read from the scroll. They all are monetary offerings, they said. They give $1,000 or $500 to the work of the Lord, to the work of the house of God. And this is a great honor to be allowed to hold the first Torah scroll. And then the procession of the scrolls moves towards the bima, which is, we call it a pulpit. But, you know, in Judaism, usually it's more of a table, you know, towards the bima and the reading table, and while everyone kisses and embraces the passing Torahs. And so usually you have them touching it with the tzitzit, you know, on there, as it's brought forward, and it's a representation, the word made flesh. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at Brother Ray. He never stops. Welcome, Brother Ray. He had a dilemma. He's working on projects for the church. He was going to stay home and finish them. I said, Ray is a saint. He's a living saint in our place. Whatever he does is fine with me. He is our living saint. Anyway, praise God. It's always good to be with him, though. So the kol nidre, I gave you the words. They're going to be on the screen as well. Let's go to the next slide, Brother Kevin. Is that the... As we stand at the threshold of a new year, this is a prayer. Hallelujah. As we stand at the threshold of a new year, we pray, may our dear ones be near to us, and may our near ones be dear to us. May our road of life be straight and smooth, but may it also be marked with the hills of challenge, and by turns which add variety and interest to our journey. May our ideas have wings, but may they always find anchor in reality. May our lives be peaceful, but may our minds grapple with ideas and our hearts wage war with cruelty and deceit. May each of us be moved to proclaim, I am not sated if anyone, anywhere, suffers hunger and want. I am not free if men's lives are controlled and their minds fettered. I am not secure if anywhere on the face of God's earth there is a brother or a sister who fears to lift their eyes in hope or his voice in prayer. May our storehouses be full and our hearts be fuller still. May we learn to find joy in that which we have rather than regret for that which we have lost. May we understand that we have been granted the gift of being able to begin anew through repentance and return. May the blessing of shalom be the inheritance of all God's children. Shalom, born of love, rooted in justice, and therefore everlasting. Heavenly Father, as the day departs and the evening arrives, we usher in the most holy day of Yom Kippur. On this day, we join with our fellow Jews, including those grafted in, throughout the world in prayer and in self-examination. We look back over the past year. We remember with shame the wrongs we did, the unkind words we spoke, and the pain we brought. We are filled with remorse, too, as we think of the many good deeds we might have done but did not do. And so we ask you to forgive us for the sins we committed in the years ahead. Make us strong so that we will not repeat the sins which we repent tonight. Help us to live in such a way that we will bring pride to our loved ones, honor to our people, and find favor before you in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. And all God's people agree and we say, Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let us play the Kol Nidre.
Kol Nidre. So
Each time you raise the pitch or the key, and that's why it repeated in different areas. But let us read what it says. All vows and binding statements and oaths, bans, restrictions, penalties, and every term that sets things out of bounds, all that we vow and swear, ban or bar from ourselves, from this Yom Kippur to next Yom Kippur, let it be for good. Each one of them we regret. Let each one be released, forgotten, undone, null and void, not in force and not in effect. Our vows are no longer vows, and our prohibitions are no longer prohibitions, and our oaths are no longer oaths. It's a cry out to God to renew us. And it's a cry out to God to free us from all entanglements. And that's why we say our oaths are no longer oaths. In fact, remember, we're even told in the New Covenant not to make oaths to God because he will require us to keep them. And so many people have made oaths to God and not able to commit to keep them. So this is a time of repentance even. Many of the rabbinical teachings say this is a time of Yom Kippur where God will release you from the consequences of your broken oaths. And isn't that what sin is a broken oath, a broken covenant between us and God? Amen? And we know that the great Yom Kippur, the great Day of Atonement came, and that Jesus paid the total price for all of our sins. But I believe with all of my heart, as I stated earlier, that these traditions and not just traditions, but instructions we receive from God himself were stolen from his body. And thank God that he caused his people, a remnant of them, to be blinded so that they were not all assimilated into Christianity and the truth of the worship of the Most High God be lost forever. God is so magnificent in the way he does things. And he redeems his people. He always has a plan to redeem. Hallelujah. I want to sing an old song. This is not a Yom Kippur song. This is a different song, but it's in the spirit of Yom Kippur. And it goes like this. And you know what? It's around. I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed.
Oh, by the blood of the Lamb.
By the blood of the Lamb.
Oh, I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed.
And I know I am.
And I know I am.
I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Saved by grace, and I know I am. All my sins are washed away. I've been redeemed. We find the concepts of Torah and the teachings of Torah throughout Scripture into the New Testament, all the way into Revelation. As we were opening up the service in the first prayers that others wrote down that I just thought were beautiful to recite, I was reminded of what Jesus said to the churches, to the seven churches. He said to repent and repeat your first works. Amen. He would say, repent and repeat your first works. Let's go back to the Garden of Eden and go to Cain and Abel. Amen. And when they offered their sacrifices, and Cain's sacrifice was not acceptable to the Lord, and he killed his brother in anger because his brother's was acceptable. But what did God tell Cain? He said, all you would have had to done was to repent and then done what was right and your sacrifice would have been acceptable to me too. So we find here in the lesson of repentance early on, right outside of the Garden of Eden, we find out that repentance and renewal, that God promises forgiveness and renewal, and that he is no respecter of persons, but that he accepts all of us when we repent and we do what is right. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We repent and we do what is right. Oh, hallelujah. I want to talk about repentance as our theme on this Yom Kippur Eve, this Holy Day. I wanted to give a couple of examples, but you know, Yom Kippur is also, commemorates traditionally the repentance of Nineveh. And tomorrow morning, most of you won't be here. And the morning reading for Yom Kippur has to do with Isaiah 57. And we'll talk about that in a little bit, because we're gonna cover a little bit of that. And the Haftorah that goes with it, or the prophets that goes with that, is Jonah. And why is Jonah brought up at Yom Kippur? Because Jonah is one of the greatest expressions of God's grace to humanity known in ancient times that we find in scripture. Because the Ninevites were known to be the most wicked people on the face of the earth at the time. They were so wicked that cannibalism was a normal practice. When they would defeat their enemy, they would have a big barbecue and they would eat them. And they would take their skins and they would stretch them like they were hides of animals. And they would use them for clothing and for lampshades. And think of all the ways we use animal skins today. Shoes and leather and lampshades and tents and all kinds. They did this with human beings, their enemies. They were a wicked, wicked, wicked people. And yet, let us go to Jonah. I'm not going to read the whole book of Jonah, but I want to go to Jonah chapter 3 and read what God said happened. Now the word of Adonai came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Rise and go to Nineveh, the great city, and cry out to the proclamation that I am telling you." So Jonah rose. Now we're talking about, this is after his disobedience, and when he was spit up by a great fish, amen, the God of Israel. So Jonah rose and went to Nineveh according to the word of Adonai. Don't you love that little about God? I was quick, because I'm a human being. I was quick to point out his failing before, right? But God started out talking about this, having the prophet report it in the Torah, or the Haftorah, I should say, by saying, "Now the word of the Adonai came to Jonah a second time, saying, 'Rise and go to Nineveh, the great city, and cry out to it the proclamation that I'm telling you.'" So Jonah rose and went to Nineveh according to the word of Adonai. I just love that, because God doesn't make any mention of the fact that he was so disobedient before. He just says, "I told him to do it," and he did it. You know, isn't that nice how God does that? He doesn't point out your wrongdoings as much as he does your right doings once you've repented. Now, Nineveh was a great city to God, the length of a three-day journey. So Jonah began to come into the city for one day's journey, and he cried out, saying, "Another 40 days and Nineveh will be overthrown." Then the people of Nineveh believed God and called for a fast and wore sackcloth from the greatest of them to the least of them. And when the word reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his robe, covered himself in sackcloth, and sat in the ashes. He made a proclamation saying, "In Nineveh, by the decree of the king and his nobles, no man or beast, herd or flock, may taste anything. They must not graze nor drink water. But cover man and beast with sackcloth. Let him cry out to God with urgency. Let each one turn from his evil way and from the violence in his hands. Who knows? God may turn and relent and turn back from his burning anger so that we may not perish." When God saw their what?
Their deeds.
When God saw their what?
Deeds.
Okay, hold on to that thought. that they turned from their wicked ways. God relented from the calamity that he said he would do to them and did not do it. We read elsewhere that faith without works is what?
Dead.
Amen. We know we are saved because of the grand supreme sacrifice of Yeshua, the Messiah, and he's the Lamb of God from the foundation of the world, and his blood was the precious blood. But we know that 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 deeds should follow, or we have no true relationship with God. We should want to please God. We don't have to. A lot of the people, when I'm trying to explain the Hebrew roots of our faith to them that God preserved for us, they say, Jesus made it so we don't have to do all those things. We don't have to. We get to. Hallelujah. We get to. Like I said to my, about, I don't know whether they're filming or not, but I said about my household, I was a little saddened that they didn't make being here a priority. But I said, this is a personal choice. It's not compulsory. I'm not going to force you. I want you to come to the house of God on Yom Kippur because it's God's chosen day of repentance. It's not my chosen day. It's God's chosen day of repentance. And I want you to love God enough that you are going to want to look at his word and compare it to your life and see how your life measures up to his word. That's not a have to. That's a get to.
Amen.
We want to please him. Amen?
Amen.
If you're on a secular job, if you're working somewhere and your boss leaves you in charge, your boss leaves you in charge and he goes away for a while, but he leaves you a book and says, this is how I did things, and keep things going till I get back. Don't you think that it would be smart to look into that book and look how your boss did things and do things the same way he did them, because you knew it was the way it was supposed to be done? Well, Jesus celebrated Yom Kippur. And Jesus went away and said he's coming back for us, but he was going to leave his Holy Spirit to reveal all things to us.
Oh.
Which is why I believe this is being restored to the church. And we should want to worship him the way he said he wanted to be worshipped. We should want to keep his commandments, knowing that there's no need of a sacrifice, that Jesus was the great sacrifice. And we know that already. But hallelujah. Amen?
Amen?
Are you following me? Are you following me? The difference in the have to and the want to? You know, we have the advantage that our Jewish brothers and sisters that have not received Yeshua or realized he is the Messiah yet, we have an advantage over them. Because we don't have to wait in hope and anticipation that the Messiah will come and will be saved. We know he has come and we have been saved. And now, because of him and his grace unto us, we are going to do our very best to follow the instructions he left for us in the Torah. I don't know about you, but when my boss comes back to check on me, I want to be found doing things the way he did them, not the way I decided would be better.
Amen.
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 You know, the Lord's really been dealing with me about a lot of this stuff, and I'm not going to put it on other people, but I'm telling you one thing. There are some changes being made in my life, and I want to be closer.
Amen.
I want to walk closer to him. I want to be able to sing the Kol Nidre from memory. You know, I want to be able to know what every word means. I want to be able to read the scripture in Hebrew. I want, you know, I'm going to make some changes, you know. I want to keep my vessel clean. Not because I have to, but because I want to. Amen. I want to know more of him. I want to know, if I can do anything like Jesus, I want to do those things the way he did them, amen, whatever they are. And so this is why we are the times and the seasons and the high holidays. He said they were a perpetual, say that word, perpetual.
Perpetual.
Perpetual feast. That means they don't have an end. They just keep going, 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 going. Amen. Hallelujah. Let us look at the Torah portion. Beginning with Isaiah 57:14. Then it will be said, build up, prepare the way, remove every stumbling block out of the way of my people. For thus says the high and exalted one who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in a high and a holy place, yet also with a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and revive the heart of the contrite. For I will not contend forever, nor will I always be angry. For the spirit will grow weak before me, the breath of those whom I made, because of the iniquity of his unjust gain. I was angry. I struck him. I hid my face. I was angry. But he went on backsliding in the way of his heart. I have seen his ways, but I will heal him. I will lead him and restore comfort to him and his mourners. Creating the praise of lips. Shalom, shalom to him who is far off and to him who is near, says Adonai, and I will heal him. But the wicked are like a troubled sea, for it cannot rest, and its waters toss up mire and dirt. There is no shalom, says my God, for the wicked.
Amen.
You know, that's a good thing to look at in our own lives. Do we have peace?
Hallelujah.
Do we have peace?
Amen.
For there's no peace for the wicked. But you see, the righteous, we can go through trials and tribulations and sufferings and yet have the peace that passes all understanding. Because the righteous are clothed in Christ Jesus, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and although we do not see the end from the beginning like Christ does, we know that he does, and we can rest in him and know that no matter what we are facing, God is going to fix it. He has. Jeremiah 29:11 says that I know the thoughts I have towards you, thoughts for good and not for evil, to give you a hope and a desired end or a future. There's two different translations, a hope and a desired end, or a hope and a future. Hallelujah. Moving on to Isaiah 58, cry aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a shofar. Tell my people their transgression and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me day to day and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that did right and had not forsaken their God's decree. They ask me for righteous judgments. They delight in the nearness of God. Why have we fasted? Yet you do not see. Why have we afflicted our souls? Yet you take no notice. Behold, in the day of your fast, you seek your own pleasure and exploit all your labors. Behold, you fast for strife and contention and to strike with a wicked fist. You should not fast as you do today to make your voice heard on high. Is this the fast I have chosen? A day for one to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head like a reed and spreading out sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast and a day acceptable to Adonai? Is not this the fast that I chose? To release the bonds of wickedness, to unite the cords of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to tear off every yoke. It is not to share your bread with the hungry. Is it not to share your bread with the hungry, to bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover him and not hide yourself from your own flesh and blood, then your light will break forth like the dawn and your healing will spring up speedily. Your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of Adonai is your rear guard. Then you will call on Adonai, will answer. You will cry, he will say, here I am. If you get rid of the yoke among you, finger pointing and bad mouthing, if you give yourself to the hungry and satisfy the desire of the afflicted, then your light will rise in darkness and your gloom will be like the midday. Then Adonai will guide you continually, satisfy your soul in drought and strengthen your bones. You will be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Some of you will rebuild the ancient ruins, will raise up the age-old foundations, will be called the repairer of the breach, restorer of the streets for dwelling. If you turn back your foot from Shabbat, from doing your pleasure on my holy day, and call Shabbat a delight, the holy day of Adonai honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, not seeking your own pleasure, nor speaking at your usual speech, then you will delight yourself in Adonai, and I will let you ride over the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your father Jacob, for the mouth of Adonai has spoken it. Do you see the message here? You understand why this is read on Yom Kippur, where this Torah portion was chosen? Do you understand that God says, don't be religious in your fast. Don't fast to get your own selfish way. Don't fast because you wouldn't have your voice heard on high. Don't fast if you haven't first repented, amen? Or if you're not fasting with a repentant heart to have the things revealed to you that are not pleasing to God. Because God wants us to cease from the things that are wicked and to do good, and to let his Holy Spirit empower us to do what is right. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. His Holy Spirit to search us and to show us and to convict us, and as we go through the scriptures later tonight, to show us where we have gone astray in our own lives and call us to personal repentance, although we are gathered together as one body. Amen. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I was going to give you some commentary from Rashi on this, but I'm not going to now. Instead, I'm going to ask Brother Paul to be prepared to come and share whatever God's put on his heart. And I just wanted to say, these are should be familiar to you now, these articles that are here, all of you that have been in our congregation. You should know these are small replicas of the Torah scrolls. They're just souvenirs that we bought when we were in Israel, you know. They're just little replicas. They're not the real thing. And then, you know, we had on our church anniversary, hallelujah, Teshuva, our great friends, Paul and Cassie Schlenvogt, they're custodians of two Torah scrolls. I'm not sure if they're dating, you can tell me on that. But they are custodians of two Torah scrolls, and they brought them here to our congregation for our anniversary. And It was such a glorious time for me personally. I just felt such an anointing of God in the household of faith. And there was something to me, I believe it's the spirit that comes with the actual Torah scrolls is one of purity, one of refinement comes into the house, and the excellence at which the scribes had to create the Torah scrolls. There were all kinds of requirements for them to be a scribe, and the care that was so diligently put into writing the Torah scroll and doing them according to God's prescribed way, being very specific to follow His instructions. It's such a blessing to me. You know, I visited the museum where the dead scrolls are in Israel. And it was such a blessing to see that when you look at all of the scripture found, you know, from the different time zones that were preserved, that only a couple of the markings in the margins had changed, you know, as their language evolved. But other than that, the actual Torah itself was preserved, and it was authentic. You could go way back to the earliest versions, and you could come to the newer versions, and you found the same Torah that you found before. Even when it came to the Codex, the Codex Linux, which was the first bound version of the Torah as a book, and you find it was still congruent with the Torah scrolls, and they're such a blessing. And so on Yom Kippur, usually you bring the Torah scrolls in, you know, they represent the Word of God. Jesus is the Word. The Word dwelt among us, made flesh and dwelt among us, amen? And so it's literally, that's why we as Christians can partake in the same things. It's the Word of God. God changes not. We can love the Word of God. That's Jesus. That's our Jesus. We love Jesus, amen? And we can love the Word, we can love the Torah, we can love the things of it. The menorah, this is not a typical Jewish menorah, but it would work because it's seven branches and seven candles, and it would have been lit at sundown by the women, and they would have said the Kiddush over that. And then this is the shofar that's blown ceremonially in many, many services. It was blown on Rosh Hashanah, we talked about that. It's blown at the conclusion of Yom Kippur as well. Big, long, huge, huge, long one. And hopefully our brother will share that. And I just brought this. This is the typical shape of a menorah. I brought that from my bubby, my little Jewish grandma, who went home already to meet her maker. She bought that for me when we were in Jerusalem on Ben Yehuda Street. And got some wax on it. They brought me some candles from Swap, but they've already burned them all down. But I just wanted to show you some of the things so they weren't foreign to you. They shouldn't be thought of as those Jewish people stuff. They are things that God used as examples. The seven branches represent so much. The seven spirits before God's throne. The perfection of Christ Jesus. But everything, there's the 7 days of creation. There's just so much represented in every single thing, in the fire itself, and in the Hanukkah on the 8 days of Hanukkah. We celebrate the menorah and Jesus being the center that was lifted up and that He bowed down to humanity. I mean, everything is about Jesus, and we should just be so excited that God is given us now the ability for knowledge to increase and the revelation from the Holy Spirit as to how we should apply that into our walks of faith. Amen? Amen. Amen. So let me ask my brother Paul Schlenvogt to come now and to share whatever God has put us on. Welcome him now.
Scriptures tell us that we should have oil in our lamp and be prepared for all seasons. I'm being caught just a little bit off guard tonight. But the Torah scrolls are, I wish I had brought them. A little heads up.
That's true.
Yes.
I gave you that Monday's notice.
half hour's notice before I left home. I love to bring them. And one of the things that I consider to be a real honor. Sometime back, I watched a documentary on the Stradivarius violins that are in the hands of the masters. And this one gentleman, he's well into his years, is commenting about the Stradivarius violin that the documentarian has alleged that he owns. And the fellow corrects him, and he says, "I don't own this instrument. He's just three times as old as I am." He's not only the custodian. I've paid for the price to be the custodian. But it's a prize. It's a reward. It's an honor. I'll be gone soon. But my obligation is to see to it that this Stradivarius is in the hands of another master.
All right.
Now, the Torah scrolls that I acquired, the Lord put it on my heart some time prior to the acquisition that I should have a Torah scroll. And I said, "Well, Lord," I said, "they're expensive and they're hard to get. And, one that's a kosher scroll, they're not just marketed to Goy, the Gentile. They're just not done that way. They're hard to get a hold of." And the Lord says, "I'll make a way." So, I'm scrapping for money. My wife and I are doing a little better today than we were back when. But I'm scrapping for money, and I put bees in the orchards, and I had some that were not up to standard to go into an orchard contract. And I put them in an area where they'd build up and develop, and they finally built up and developed to where I could use them, generations of brood cycles. And I could use them. They were really great, but the trees were pretty well blown. So I left the situation in the hands of my son, and I drove a bus to Colorado that had been acquired in California. I drove it to Colorado for a donation to a charity. Now, I wasn't the purchaser, but I was the driver. And I'm heading over the mountains of Colorado. My cell phone hasn't worked for an hour, and suddenly my phone rings. And this lady calls me, who I recognize the voice of coincidence would be. It was a client who had rejected my services, and they were desperately looking for some bees. And the Lord put it on my heart and said, "There's the money." So I contacted my son. He says, "I can take care of it. I'll meet with them. I'll put them in." I got in the bus again and proceeded down the mountain. And within a mile of that location, I had no more cell phone signal for another 45 minutes. I don't know how that happened. But I wound up with the funds to acquire a Torah scroll, and I sat down, of all things, on eBay, and I'm looking for Torah scrolls, right? And the Lord put it on me that this is yours. Oh, okay. And so I commented to the people. I says, I'd like to, have this scroll, They said, or best offer. I said, "Well, what do you want for this scroll?" They gave me a figure, and I sent them the money, and I wound up with a cashier scroll at my doorstep. But while I'm doing this, I'm thumbing down through, once again, eBay, and the same day, and the Lord says, "This one too." I said, "Really?" So when it's over, this one was shipped out of Israel, and, it's... They don't sell those things to Goy. Okay, now one of them is a survivor of the Holocaust. It's an Ashkenaz style Torah, and it predates the Second World War. Just by how much, I don't know, somewhere in the 30s. And the other one is in the Maghreb style. It was prepared somewhere in the neighborhood of 1860, in timing with our Civil War. Now, every time I open those scrolls, I get goosebumps. You know, and we all speak of, you know, feeling the Holy Spirit in our presence. And I love to take them places, and I open them with great reverence. When I open those boxes that hold them, the arcs that hold them, it's like a wave that hits me. It just gives me goosebumps. And I really enjoy having them. And one of the things that I've also learned to understand is the scriptures in New Testament, and especially New Testament, that tells us we are supposed to observe the Torah, the first five books. And very, very important. And, you know, I hesitate to step on people's ideas, but the law has never really been done away with. It's never been done away with. And when Stephen was stoned, he was stoned why? Because he was accused by false witnesses for preaching against the law of Moses. And what is the law of Moses but the first five books? And now it was false witnesses. Now had he and Yeshua said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." What's the continuation of that? Nobody sees the Father except through me. Right? Okay. There are idioms in scriptures. What is an idiom? An idiom is a group of words, a phrasing, that has a far deeper meaning than what is on the surface level.
All right.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. Mm-hmm. And the Torah was known as the way. Mm-hmm. The Torah was known as the truth. The Torah was known as the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life, meaning he himself was the living Torah. And there is no way to the Father but through him, the living Torah. Now, he was synonymous with the Torah. And the feasts are perpetual feasts. The holy days are perpetual holy days to be observed for perpetuity, forever. And hence, my joy, my thrill of owning these texts. And one of the things that is also very, very fascinating is, and I'd have to go back to my original notes, but the American Indians had names for the Great Spirit. And the names for the Great Spirit are actually Paleo-Hebrew names for Yah. And inscriptions that the American Indians used, many of which are found in hieroglyphs, are inscriptions in the form of Hebrew that is considered Paleo-Hebrew. Hebrew that wasn't even being used in the 1860s. It dates back to 400-600 years before the birth of Christ. Paleo-Hebrew. So we understand, archaeologists understand, that the Hebrew language, the understanding of the Great Spirit, was presented to the American Indian. Now, of course, the question, of course, is, were there prophets that came to the American continent, or did the ancestors come from the old continent that brought this with them? And, of course, you know, I mean, that's wonderful academic dialogue, but the real essence is what we really know today. On Yom Kippur, the Yemenite shofar, from the greater kudu antelope, is a beautiful horn. The ones that I have play the same notes as the silver trumpet. And they are, you know, in the hands of, I mean, I'm okay with one, but there are great masters of the shofar. And you cannot really tell the difference between the silver trumpets and the Yemenite shofar. But in Yom Kippur, it's more typically used is the ram's horn. And the ram's horn, I mean, for part of the service, in the culmination of the service, they use the silver shofar. But the ram's horn shofar has a far more wailing tone. And there are different types of ram's horns. What I do not have with me is a very high-pitched horn, and rather compact, and it's an awesome carrying sound. And you can really understand how people could use that for the sake of a battle call, because it's very shrill, and it's easily heard above the din of battle, and if an alarm call, it would be heard through the night. The larger ram's horn has more of a wailing sound. And commemorative of the Day of Atonement and our need and our obligation to step through this portal, this door of opportunity to seek repentance and seek God's blessings. He's merciful. He's full of mercy. Amen. And mercy in the Old Testament was like, mercy has always been there. Mm-hmm. And it's David who cursed Uriah and had a child through Bathsheba. He received mercy. And if God can present David with mercy and grace, then these patriarchs in the scriptures, they're there for a reason. And you know, as we try to emulate, to live up to the standards of these patriarchs, if as we read the scriptures and we read the stories of David, this great warrior, he fell. We can be great warriors, but we're going to fall, and we can have grace. Jonah, this wonderful story of Jonah, I didn't understand it, but I've heard this fabulous message from an archaeologist who had been through the city of Lachish, and Lachish was a northern city that was lost in the diaspora of the northern tribes. This is just prior to the time of Jonah. And it was the Ninevites, the Assyrians from Nineveh, that had taken Lachish. And after they took Lachish, they put this big governor's palace there at Lachish. And in here were these murals that represented the taking of Lachish. And in Nineveh, the king's entryway, his anteroom, was also done up in murals showing the taking of the city of Lachish. Now, I've been reprimanded for just describing what was representative in these murals. But they had stakes in the holes in the ground where they put poles. And the captors were separated into groups of men, and the murals on the walls depicted the separation of the captors. The eldest, the most diehard, the most determined of these were impaled on these stakes. And what they did is they lifted these men up and they dropped them on these stakes. I know what I would look like if I was in the belly of a great fish for 3 days and three nights. But did God bless him to look like he just hadn't even been there? I don't know. But he approaches the Ninevites and tells them to repent. And with this history and God's power, they repented.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it was God's plan for him to not go there in the first place.
He knew his heart.
At first,
we could be involved in philosophy, and I can't disagree with your reasoning. You know, God knew his heart.
Mm-hmm.
But now I'm going to tell you a story about myself. As a young man, I came from the Dakotas, and I came to California. And I wore Wellington boots. My father wore Wellington boots. He was a farmer. I was just 8 years old. And 8-year-old kids in California wear tennis shoes. Now, you know what Wellington boots are. They're a flat-soled work boot, typically a biker's style boot with the leather strap across the top, the buckle on the side. So I show up with these Wellington boots going to school. My mother and my father, they had lived through the Great Depression as children, through the Second World War, and I had patches on my blue jeans. My mother was very proud of how well she could patch blue jeans. I wore patched blue jeans to school. You don't wear patched blue jeans to school in California. You don't do that. And I've also now learned to understand, I have a little bit of a visual difficulty with three-dimensional things. I can't play sports with a hoop. If I try to catch a baseball, it'll fold my thumbs back, try to catch a basketball, hit me in the nose. Okay, so I'm this kid going to school that doesn't fit in. And there was a couple young fellas there that were they also didn't fit in. One of these young fellas was just kind of light and frail. A good kid, you know, and he just smaller than everybody else. And clean cut, didn't like to rabble rouse. Another young fella had a leg that wasn't doing right, so they put a brace on it, and they put like a spring-loaded loop on the bottom, like a pogo stick, so his other leg would match so he could walk. They had a big cork riser. It was about 3 inches tall, and he'd be walking down the hallway, and these other kids, they'd see him coming, and Kenny's coming, and as he's swinging his leg like Chester, they put their foot out, and they trip him on his face. Kapok. And if I was there, the fight was on. And I was in scraps with these young people so often that I just made a, I had a pathway beat to the principal's office, because who started it? Paul did. You know? And I couldn't for the life of me understand how these teachers could be blind. I've got a real thing about authority figures, because I've got this figured out. The only thing authority figures have a problem with is disruption in their harmony. So they don't really want to do anything, they just don't want their harmony disrupted. And I was disrupting their harmony. And I was bringing their attention to the elephant in the room, which was these bullies who were treating these kids wrong. And anyway, there, many years later, there's a long story behind this, but many years later, I met this fellow in my hometown. And I thought he was someone from the Clusa area that from time to time wandered in and out of a semi-homeless condition. And I'm kind of trying to, you know, I'm looking over at him and is that you? And he looked at me and he spoke up and he said, no, obviously it wasn't. So I tried to ignore him. It's 2:00 in the morning. I need to go to a motel and go to bed. I've got to get going at 6 in the morning. I don't have time. All I want to do is catch a donut and at this little donut shop. It was the only thing that was open and go to bed. So he starts asking me questions. And I find out that I grew up in this community now, mind you. And he's a couple years older than I am. And his younger brother was in my junior high. But he starts telling me of all the kids that I had You know, he starts asking me questions, lots of questions. Mm-hmm. Then he starts telling me, well, you graduated in class of such and such. I said, well, yeah. And he asks me some more questions, which I'm avoiding, and I give him a couple little tidbits, and he's moving on. He says, oh, yeah, you went to H.G. Hyde Elementary School. Yeah. I mean, this guy's a genius. I knew this guy. I mean, he was nothing but a rabble-rouser. He was a bonehead. He was a problem kid going through school. And then I find out his story. And what had happened to him is that he and his younger brother had bounced around trying to make it through life. And he wound up, this guy wound up in Southern California doing drugs, wound up on a rescue mission. He came to the conclusion he had to go home. So he went back to this community. Another young fellow that I went to school with had put him up in a caretaker shack at a cemetery. This other kid I went to school with was the caretaker of the cemetery. So we put him up in the shack. That's where you stay in. And he tells me about what happened to all these kids that I went to school with. Now, there were two classes. There was two, for every first grade, there were two rooms, every fifth, third, second, etc. So there's about 30 kids in each room, and he starts, 60 total, 30 guys, 30 girls, starts telling me what happened to these kids. Now, I kid you not. I mean, I grew up, went to high school with some of these kids, and I'm walking down the hallway, and I wind up bent over double from a kick to the groin. You know, these kids were the Assyrians. They were the Nineveh of my life. Mm-hmm. Now, he's telling me what happened to him. And he says, this guy, he says, he was doing drugs, and he wound up in an institution, and he's out now, and he's homeless someplace. And he says, this other fella, he says, he hung himself in jail, and his older brother hung himself in jail.
Yeah.
I said, oh, okay. And then he said, and that one over there, he says, so-and-so, he cut his foot in a piece of glass out on the beach, got blood poisoning, and died. And he's going on down the list, and so-and-so's in an insane asylum, and so-and-so is doing it. And I want to get through, out of the 30 boys, there was four or five that had a life that I might want to share. Mm. Out of the other 25 out of 30, they had a life that was horrible. Horrible, or they were dead. Mm-hmm. And the young ladies that were there, he's describing what happened to some of these ladies, and this one that was a particularly good-looking young girl who was always trying to intimidate people and do weird stuff, and she was the hooker down at the lounge. And he's going off about the other, and I'm thinking, wow. Now, I no longer wanted to do these people hurt. I no longer had an anger for these people. I cried. Now, Jonah went to Nineveh. They repented. Mm-hmm. And Jonah didn't want to go. And he didn't want to go because the Ninevites were not good people. The Ninevites had taken all of northern Israel and put it into a diaspora and scattered them through the world. Mm-hmm. Done all these atrocities to all of these people. He did not want them restored. Today, I have a whole lot different sense of understanding. A whole lot different sense of compassion for the people that walk the streets.
Yeah.
And the homeless people out here, the statistics are something like 60-70% of them have suffered major traumatic head injuries in their life. Yeah. My wife was asking me today about a homeless camp we passed along the freeway. She says, this is unbelievable. It's right in plain sight. Why don't they do something about it? I said, because they can't. What are they going to do with them? What are they going to do? They can't hold a job. They can't function in society. Are you going to institutionalize them? You can't do that. You're going to provide them with a house? They don't want to live in a house. They trash it. They want to be independent. Their personal habits are unacceptable to any landlord. I mean, what can you do with them? The only thing you can do with them is try to feed them, to be compassionate, and to pray that the good Lord takes care of them and has mercy on them. Our Nineveh is around us every day. The Day of Atonement. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Brother Ray, I'm going to put you on the spot. Can you just come up here for a minute?
Huh?
Can you come up here for a minute?
I'm not prepared for anything.
What's that?
I'm not prepared for anything.
That's okay. You don't have to be prepared. You don't have to be prepared because I want to brag on you a little bit. You know, the Word of God says we're to be living epistles. And until recently, this man right here, he would say, I'm just a retired fireman. But all the time, he was working for the kingdom of God. And he was doing more work in the kingdom of God than most of the pastors I know. And in fact, even here, when he came here and all the work he does on the church and all the things he does on the church, it's through the way that he gently loves these young men and everything that he's been able to invite two young men back into fellowship that didn't want anything to do with the church. And they've been coming on their own merits to church. And it's a surprise. If they knew Ray was here tonight, they would have been here tonight. But Brother Ray, just, you don't have to be prepared. And I wanted you just to talk from your heart a couple minutes about living for God. And what that means, like living a life of doing what is right instead of just doing what you want, how you can tell the fruit, something along those lines about repenting, and how you know, just a minute or something, or say, talk about Peru or whatever, but just give me an example of how you walk out your faith day to day.
Well, I work a lot on suggestions and based on things that God wants me to do. Like right now, I'm working on the columns. So I can't finish the room because it wasn't dry enough, so I'm building the columns that for Pastor Timothy up here. And they're home. So I was not even going to come tonight because I was so busy working on those. But I just sort of work on my whole life is based on just doing what the Lord tells me to do, and I don't ask for anything for it. I've designed and built churches and stuff, and I go back and I ask the pastors if I can give my testimony. They're interested. And it's kind of disheartening, but it's all in the Lord's hands when I do things. I'm not a man of a lot of words because I can write if I can sit down and think about it. But I don't, that's the reason my wife does all the talking. She fills in for me.
Yeah.
But some years ago, I retired from the Sacramento City Fire Department in 1990. And then prior to those years, I had housed a girl from Peru and getting her degree at EPIC, which was formerly known as Trinity Life Bible College. And she lived with us as she was going to school, and then when she graduated, she went back to Peru. She wasn't married when she was here, and she went back to Peru and married a proven military weapons officer. And while he was, he asked her to marry him, but she said, no, I can't marry you because the Lord told me to marry a pastor. A minister, and he said, "Well, you know what you don't know is the Lord has called me in a ministry." He was a licensed. I mean, he was a full a captain in the military. There had to do with all the weapons of Peru. And in that, he married her while he was in the military, but then the Lord did. He called him in the ministry. And then one day the Lord called him to get his doctor's degree in education, and so did Rosie. So they went to Brazil, but the reason they went to Brazil is because an assassin team came to kill him in the platform because he knew too much about the weaponry of Peru. While he was preaching one Sunday, and a runner that was a friend of his took him to sneaked him off to from Peru and sneaked him off to Brazil. And in Brazil, they spent the next 12 years starting three Assemblies of God churches while they were there. And at the same time, they got their doctor's degree in education. Then, while they were still in Brazil, they called me and said, "Dad, would you help us start the work in Peru?" Well, I'm nothing but a firefighter, right? I'm nothing. What can I do to help anybody? So I took the Lord at His word, and I flew to Peru. I didn't even know what in the world I was doing there. When I landed in Peru, I didn't even know. My goodness, Lord, where did You bring me? I've never been to a place like this before. I've been all over the world, but I've in military, but nothing like this. And the airplane flew in. A great big airplane flew into a weed patch. And they have a bunch of people coming to greet me. Well, when Rosie came and met me at the airport, and through the time I was there, I went looking for a property for her, and by then, in the meantime, I didn't find any property, and when I came home, I was still thinking about what to do, and I had major surgery, and I couldn't rotate like everybody did for quite some time. So one day, still recovering from the surgery, Barb asked Brian Jacks if he was a real estate guy, if he would mind just flying with me to Israel, to Peru, and start the property, see if we can find property, because he knew how to handle that kind of stuff more than I did. I had seen the property that we bought because Rosie called me and took me to his dad. I'd like to have this piece of property. My goodness, I looked at that, it was nothing but a piece of junk. And it was brick walls and stuff like that, and no roof on it, and oil tanks inside and everything else, and it was an abandoned oil company building. But God called me to get things going there, and Brian, we just still didn't buy the property till we got home. And Rosie called me one day and said, "Dad, they've made that property available to us at a reasonable price." It was $105,000 in Peru, and it's nothing but a weed patch. $105,000. I didn't have a dime in my pocket to start with, much less buy $105,000, but the Lord said, "Buy it." So I went over a year. I said, "Okay, if the Lord's in it," I said, I'll pay for it in a year in three equal payments. I tried to get the school that we got started, I tried to get the Assemblies of God to take it over, and nothing, they didn't, wouldn't have anything to do with it. So I'm trying to get my thoughts on it. So I went ahead, and friends began to see that what I was doing was serious, and each payment was made exactly on time, with $33,000 at a time, was made on time for the first 3 months. The first three payments, first two payments. The third payment was finally due, and it was not. I had the money, but I had sent it to Peru on a wrong number in an international funds transfer. I don't know where the money was to go. Then I went to the bank and told them what I did, because Rosie said the money didn't come. So I had to wait till Monday. This was on Friday. I had to wait till Monday. Monday came and I went to the bank, and the bank said, "Don't worry about it. We'll send another one, and we'll get the other one straightened out for you." Well, by this time now, there's two times $333,000 had sent there, and it was, one was overdue, over amount, and they wanted to keep it. So, because I had sent it, no, that was their money. No, it's not your money. It was a mistake. So we told Rosie, "Don't you fall for that." So that anyhow, the Peruvian was waiting for their money, and they were mad at us because the third payment wasn't paid on time. So they took the money did come in, finally came in, and the banker said, "Bring three suitcases with you," and this was after the bank had closed. "Bring three suitcases with you, and we'll pay you $33,000-something in $5 bills, American $5 bills." So I had to put it in three suitcases to pay. Finally, the Peruvian was mad at us because the money didn't come. And finally, when the money came, they had to walk through the market. The market today is not like the market was then, because the market then, you had, everybody was out on, it was like like selling goods in a garbage dump. And you had to walk through the market, and you had to have your hands on your wallet and everything else. They took the three suitcases, the real estate man and Rosie, and they took the three suitcases and walked right through the market and didn't have a policeman at all to help them. And when they got there, the Peruvian was waiting, and they laid out the three suitcases full of $5 bills. You could hear them say, in their language, "I never seen that much money at one time." Mm-hmm. Anyhow, they got their money, and it was paid in full. Today, Timothy went with me the last time and couldn't believe the success of what had happened. But prior to that, Rosie had said to me, "Dad, Ugo is branching out all over the place." And so he took me, when I was there the next time before Timothy and them, he took me up to Huancayo. We started our second Bible college there, and our first Bible college in the piece of junk where we had. Today we've got 33 classrooms plus now, I believe. And we've taught enough people to start 128 new churches? 128 new churches. And I was rejected totally by the Assemblies of God, and the Lord is branching out. We got the Bible College in Huancayo. We have another one south of, in the north part of Peru, inland, quite a few miles, almost to Brazil, in the jungle. We have a Bible college there. We have a Bible college in Huancayo, and a Bible college now in Puta. All because I followed through even though I had nothing in my pocket. God took something and made, took nothing and made something out of it. And it's just the way it is. And I'm not a spokesman. You can tell that by me telling you the story. I can't even read well when in front of public because I've had eyesight problems. I was burned in the face in the fire department, given 6 days to live, and I was operated on, and I was for 10 months I was off work, couldn't see to drive. So, and finally when I went back to work, I lost my confidence on a roof. I was so uncomfortable and so poor in vision that I just had to retire. And that's how come I retired. But then during that process, I designed Woodland Assemblies of God Church as a church seats about 500. It's a modern construction and a slope floor, a theatrical slope floor. Now, mind you, I don't have a degree in anything, but I have designed machinery for the government. I've designed machinery for Aerojet, and it's not because I asked for it. The jobs would be given to me, and God helped me do something that I didn't have even the qualifications to do. And it's just sort of my life has been that way. I designed the parachute drop for the U.S. Coast Guard. It's used in every Coast Guard plane around the world today.
Wow.
And these are just some of the things. It's not because of me, but it's because of the glory of God and His ability. He's given me the ability out of nothing.
Right.
And the scripture says, "If God before you, who could be against you?"
That's right.
And that's about the extent of what
we've got. Thank you.
Praise God. It's always good to hear that.
Yeah.
Praise. I've got time for a couple more. Elder Watts, do you want to come and talk about how you repented of what God told you? And then how he used you. I said, come on, we're talking about repentance here. Amen. Come on, let's. I didn't tell them they're going to talk because they might not show up.
That's true.
But anyway, we went to a revival at a church back home, and the Spirit of the Lord got a hold of me. And so I shouted and shouted and shouted and tried to get out of the church door, but the church door wouldn't open up. And when I wound up laying up in the podium, and I didn't realize and didn't understand why I was there or what I was there for. And you have a tendency to ask different peoples and ask the pastor and you ask some of the evangelists and they still don't give you the answer that you are looking for. And when you're young, you're dumb and you're stupid and you don't have time enough to ask God about what he wants you to do. So I went on 22 years later. So when I turned 44 years old, went to a revival, had a revival, and people had been asking me before that, where is your church at? Where are you preaching at? Are you a pastor of a church? I said, no, I ain't no pastor at no church. I don't have no church. And not preaching at no church. And so we went into a shut-in. And this was in July, the 18th. We went in on the 18th and came out on the 20th. So during the shut-in, I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, if it meant for me to preach your word, teach your word, you don't have to distract me and let me know. You know, and so that's a challenge with God. And you don't challenge God. And so went home, got all cleaned up, dressed, and everybody went back to church. Opened up service, and after opening up service and everything, called up the praise and worship team for testimony. And while that was going on, had an aneurysm. And that's a busted blood vessel in this side of your head that operates the right side of your body. And so when I had that, when they got me to the hospital, from what I was told, it was 1 pint of blood left in the body. And so they done surgery and said I went into a coma twice while they was getting ready to do that. And they had to take me back to the room and take me up to intensive care. So after all this was done and over, while I was in the hospital, it was an angel dressed in solid white standing at the foot of the bed. Nobody seen that angel but me. And I asked everybody, I said, did y'all see that person standing at the foot of the bed? They go, what person? I said, dressed in white, standing at the foot of the bed. And we ain't seen nobody standing at no foot of no bed. And I says, okay, Lord, that was you. And so during this time, I had to go to physical therapy, speech therapy, and all this stuff, learn how to walk again, learn how to talk again, and all of this. And I says, okay, I'm a walker. And so wife took me and dropped me off at church for Bible study. And so I had this walker, went in, and I had told her maybe 3 or 4 months prior to that walker was going to go one way and I was going the other. I don't want to be confined to no bed. I don't want nobody taking care of me 24 hours a day. And so the Lord healed my body, gave me my speech pattern back, gave me my walk back, and also gave me the understanding to teach and preach his word. So I'm glad God done what he done to make me understand what he wanted me to do. And I'll tell anybody, if you got a calling on your life, don't ask no questions, don't challenge God, do what he wants you to do, because he's called you to a work no man can do but you.
Brother Vince, this is a mighty man of God. You have something to share with us tonight on repentance. I've known Brother Vince now, almost 30 years. He looks the same, I look old and fat, so I don't know what's going on there, but.
Okay, so, when Jesus started his ministry, he said, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God's, repent and believe the gospel, the kingdom of God's at hand. And before that, John the Baptist was saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And so probably about a year ago, I was thinking like, man, you know, I really want to study about the kingdom of God and learn about it. So I thought, well, I want to go online and I want to go hear some of the major ministries, what they have to do, right? So you can go on their websites and you can do a search. Or you go on YouTube, and you can do a search to find out what messages they preach, right? Well, I went to one, crickets, nothing. Went to another one, nothing. Went to another one, nothing. I'm like, how is it that all these major ministries, like no one's preaching the kingdom of God? And so I started, so that really put me on a real fast, I mean, I've just been spending hours upon hours upon hours. I actually took every single place where it said Kingdom of God, I put it together, I did searches on it where it says Inherit the Kingdom, and I did full research on it, and a lot of extended out of that, I really feel the Lord has really spoken to me. But one thing, when John the Baptist was saying, repent, for the Kingdom of God is at hand, you got to remember the context of who he was talking to, who he was preaching to. He was preaching to Jews. Mm-hmm. So when he said, repent, for the Kingdom of God is at hand, what he meant by repentance, because he had the spirit of Elijah on him, he was talking about getting back to the Torah, getting back to the law, getting back to all the things that God said. Yes. When Jesus came on the scene, he was saying the same, repent, get back. And every time he healed someone, he would say, go offer to Moses, or go offer to the priest, that was just spoken by Moses. So when you're reading the Old Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that's all messages of a message from God to the Jewish people. And when he said repent, and he meant it, he said get back to the law. It wasn't until Acts chapter 15 where, Cornelius, when it was spoken to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles came in. But you have to, when you're realizing, when Jesus is talking about the Kingdom of God, or when John the Baptist is talking about the Kingdom of God, and repent. And one thing also is that he said the law and the prophets were until John. Since that time, the Kingdom of God is preached and every man presses into it. So if you look, one of the first messages that Jesus preached when he went into his hometown, he said, the Spirit of God is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to preach deliverance to the captives, healing the sight to the blind, right? And to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And then he goes on and he says, no prophet is without honor, save in his own country, right? And then he starts talking about Elijah and Elisha. And when you look at Elijah, his whole call was to turn the hearts of the children back to Israel. When he called fire down, he said, get them to repent. Then he killed the prophets of Baal because they had gotten away from the law. They were serving other gods. So I believe that we are at the precipice. There will be declarations. There will be, the time is fulfilled. The Kingdom of God. It says in Matthew chapter, I think it's 24, it says, and this gospel will of the kingdom will be preached, and then shall the end come. We are about ready to see a release, number one, of that message.
Yes.
And that repentance message. And part of that is actually getting back to the law. Jesus said, whoever teaches men to go against the law will be least in the kingdom of God. Whoever teaches men to do these will be great in the kingdom of God. And so the law is very, very important. Now what happened is that what Jesus did, he said, this is going to be written on your hearts. Mm. And one time I had an experience. How am I doing on time?
You're fine.
Okay, so Jan and I were praying and we were confessing the word one night. And we were just doing declarations of the word of God, the word of God. And I was going into Joshua and we were just confessing the word. And has anyone ever heard the Carmen? You guys know Carmen?
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever heard that song, Jericho? Okay, well, prior to that, as I had asked, I said, why is the Ark of the Covenant the most valuable piece in the temple, right? It's the center focus of the whole temple. And I go, when you get to the New Testament, why don't you ever hear anything about, and not that he didn't, but there's nothing recorded, at least, of Jesus talking about the Ark of the Covenant. It's mentioned one time in Hebrews, and then it's mentioned in Revelation. And I go, and that's it. I go, why is the most valuable piece of the Old Testament, Ark of the Covenant, not even really even mentioned in the New Testament? And have you guys ever thought about that?
Mm-hmm.
So I was questioning, and I started doing research, and then Jan said, Vince, come on, you know, a lot of people get weird, and they start looking for the actual covenant, and they get all weird. So Jan kind of said, just back off, and, you know, so I said, you know what, you're right. So I backed off the issue. And but I really was puzzled, like, how, it was like a divine question, like, how could that be talked about so much and then not even be mentioned? Well, so we were confessing the word. So that was like 2 weeks prior to this, you know, us, Jan and I are just praying, confessing the word. Well, I go to play that song, and I put on that song from Carmen, and called Jericho. And if you remember about Jericho, they were marching the Ark of the Covenant, right, around Jericho. And then on the seventh time, right? Well, when he gets to that song, Pastor Tim, he hits a crescendo. And when it says shout, you know, and then when the walls came down. Well, if you have ever had this experience, it talks about in the Bible when it says the Holy Spirit fell. It actually says that, right? Well, sometimes you don't understand a verse until it actually happens to you. At that moment in that song, and if Jan was here, she could testify to it, the Holy Spirit fell on us. I mean, I can't even explain it unless it's happened to you. You know what I'm talking about. It's like he just comes from up here and just falls, and his presence magnifies the whole room. Well, I went into a vision, and then the Lord told, and I saw four priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant up into a church like this, and they were carrying the Ark, getting ready to go up onto the where the platform was, and the Lord said, wherever you see Ark of the Covenant in the Old Testament, think Holy Spirit. It said, when you get to the New Testament and you wherever you read Holy Spirit, you think Ark of the Covenant. You put the two together and he goes, you'll understand me. And at the same moment, Jan, I said, Jan, she goes, don't bug me. She goes, I'm having a vision. She was having a vision of that. And she didn't know what I was going through. Which was a high priest, as you can see that, a high priest, a high priest in the clouds with the Ark of the Covenant. And when that happened, I mean, I was in a different state for a few days. It was one of the most wonderful, powerful experiences I've ever had in my life. And do you guys know in Isaiah, where he says he saw the Lord, he goes, woe is me, I am undone.
Mm-hmm.
I went into a state of repentance. Mm-hmm. And it was deep. I mean, deep. You know, and God dealt with me in some, you know, Pastor Tim kind of knows my story, but he dealt with me in some areas in my heart at a level that was just beyond. And all I can say is, you know, we are the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, the Ark of the Covenant is representation of actually the Holy Spirit. Some people say, no, it's Jesus, no, it's that. You know, I went and I talked to Bible scholars after. I went to Bible college. I know the Bible very, very well. I talked to Bible scholars, I talked to people who know the Bible, and they said, Vince, we never heard that before, but he goes, but that is true. It was of the Lord. And if you do some research, a lot of people say, no, it represents Jesus. No, it represents, it's actually made like a throne. And inside the Ark of the Covenant has the Ten Commandments. And then actually the Torah was not inside the Ark of the Covenant. It was laid in the Holy of Holies next to the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was brought into battle, was brought into war. It's the meeting place with God.
Mm-hmm.
And when I believe what God wants, because remember, on this day, what happens? The high priest goes in once a year, where? Into the holy place, right? Now, since then, when Jesus died on the cross, the veil was rent. What does that mean, right? So that everyone has access now. Not only do we have access to God, but God has access to us. And our body has now become the temple of the Holy Spirit. And it's the most valuable thing. The kingdom of God is though a man found treasure in a field. Look, There is nothing more valuable. The kingdom of God is a relationship by the Spirit, through the authority and power of the Spirit, with Jesus and the Father. And they all work together, and that's the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not just about Jesus, not just about the Father, it's all three of them. The meeting place with the high priest was above where the cherubims were at, above the mercy seat. Well, the mercy seat, well, that's where the king sits. The king, Jesus, and the Father rule his kingdom by the Holy Spirit. And it's a three-way relationship. And we have to have a relationship, all three of them. And when the Holy Spirit comes into you, it is the most valuable, valuable thing. That's why Jesus died on the cross, so that we could enter back into what Adam lost. Why do you think he quit shining? Why do you think he needed clothes? He was no longer clothed with the glory of the Holy Spirit. So, and he lost the full relationship with God. And his body was no longer a temple anymore. And then devils started coming in and out. If you read there, you know, devils were going in and out of Judas. You know, Jesus was casting devils. When God came on the scene, it was the first time in the history since the fall of man, other than maybe when David played the harp, where devils started coming out of people. When Jesus started preaching the kingdom, because what he was saying, look, he says, the house is full, right? It's garnished. And he says, but then when a wicked spirit leaves, it wants to come back. And if it finds it empty, it'll bring seven more wicked. What do you mean empty? No Holy Spirit there.
Yeah.
But when the Holy Spirit is inside of you, you're no longer empty. He can't come back in.
Amen.
But if you sin, you break the Ten Commandments, you go against the Torah. See, let me tell you how devils operate. Devils operate by permission, and they're territorial. If you understand that, and that's how God operates too, by permission and territory. When you sin, you give permission, and then through permission, they take territory. That's how houses get haunted, that's how animals get haunted, and that's how people get demon-possessed. It can happen through various forms, but it's through breaking of the laws and the commandments of God. Plain and simple. But if you look, there's a lot about the conscience, about the blood of Jesus cleansing the conscience and the laws being written on our heart. That's tying in the Torah being written on your heart. You living consciously, look, don't violate. If you feel the Holy Spirit saying, don't do that, don't do that. You know, we've heard of men that maybe get into immorality. Look, sexual immorality says you can do many sins, but you sin, you do that one, you sin against your own body. And you've allowed devils to come right into you. And look, God goes out and the devil comes in. It's as plain as simple as that. But this day of repentance, it's a removing, it's a repenting. If there's anything on your conscience, if God's bringing anything to your mind or your heart about anything, this is the day when we go through it to repent about all of that. When you repent of all of that, it's getting where there's no more foothold of the devil in you, where he can't have access. This is a temple. And that's why we have to study the Torah. That's why we have to study these things, because we learn how to walk with God. God said, I'll be with them. I'll be in them. I'll walk amongst them. When we violate his law, he goes. He's no longer welcome. We have to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. When you pray, thy kingdom come, you're asking the Holy Spirit to come in. And through that relationship with the Holy Spirit, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. He that hath my commandments and keep them, he does that love me. Right? And I will love him, and my Father will love him, and we will come and make our abode with him. You'll have visitations of the Father. You'll have visitations of Christ. You'll have visitations of the Holy Spirit. If you disobey God, you'll have visitations of the devil. You'll have nightmares. You'll have dreams. You'll have sicknesses. It's really that simple. So these laws are meant to be written on our heart. And that's why we study these things. So we can learn how, not just, it's not a religious form. It's not done away with. This is a shadow of things to come.
Yeah.
When we look at the temple, when we study this, we go, wow, that is supposed to be in here. The ark is in me. I'm the temple. If they're about ready to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem, right? Do you realize the temple, there has not been a temple in Jerusalem since 40 years after the death of Christ? That means for the last about 2,000 years, there's been no temple.
Amen.
The Jews can't even go and even keep the law if they wanted to.
No, sir.
In that area.
I know.
And it's about right. Why? Because Jesus said, look, in 3 days, you know, I'll destroy this temple and I'll restore it, because he from that point forward, he became the temple of the Holy Spirit, and he allowed us to become the temple of the Spirit. And as a body, that's why it's so important in here when you have a body. It's like, you know, when you look at Achan, he sinned. It even matters what you do and who you hang out with, because corporately we're a temple.
Yes.
And if we're going to have manifestations of the Spirit of God in this place, people can't be living in sin.
Amen.
You've got, look, he is a holy God.
Yes,
and it's a privilege to walk in these commandments and have these written in our heart.
Thank you, brother. I wasn't cutting you off, staring at you. Praise God. That was a good teacher, right?
Yeah.
We never know what God's going to bring when we come together in the Lord. Right. I promised we would close at 9 for the first section. And so I would like Brother Kevin to get the finale ready. But as they do, it's a celebration. You know, being Jewish, and we're grafted in, so like it or not, you need to start embracing that Jewish heritage. So whether you are born a Jew or you're grafted in, like, and I want to make sure and get this on camera. Are you still recording?
Yep.
Praise God. I want everybody to come up around here. It's about family. It's about community. That's the whole thing about the family of God. And we might not know the words to these Hebrew songs, but we can enjoy being together and kind of hum them and stuff as we close out until we learn some of these songs. But let's come up together and close this section of our, so we'll have Kevin start it, and I want Kevin to come on up as well, and we'll deal with editing the camera later. And let's just be together. Let's, you'll see on the screens the final. This is at the Park Avenue, the Synagogue of New York on Park Avenue, with a cantor, Azi Schwartz. And boy, this man is anointed. I mean, he doesn't even know Yeshua unless he's met him recently. This morning, I was in my office early looking for the clips to play. And I'm telling you, while I was playing this, the Spirit of the Lord fell in such a heavy way. I don't think I've had such a divine visitation in years. It fell.
Yeah.
It just fell from heaven. And I was just, I was crying to the Lord, and I had, without even thinking about it, the Lord said, he kept saying, restore, restore, restore. And I believe what he was saying, restore everything back to your people that was taken and stolen from them. And it's not the popular thing, but it's the right thing. It's what God is doing. And those that have an ear to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church, they hear. And they know what's going on. Let's play that, Brother Kevin. Let's make sure we can see.
La 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 la.
Oh,
Moshech ben Israel Amim Ben Yom Ashri Lesheshet Yemei Amaseh Baruch Ata Adonai Hamavdi Ben Kodesh Lechol Shema
such a small number of men that did come. I know my boy is on the way. We are going to invite anyone that would like to stay. We're just going to we're going to ask the, just a tradition that the women, if you stay, that you sit on the left, my left side, and the men, we sit on the right side. And we're going to go through, for the next few hours, we're going to go through repentance. We're going to go through the 613 commands, the good commands and the bad commands, and the do's and the do nots, the mitzvot, they're called, all of them, found in the Torah. And as we go through them, when we read them, we're going to let the Holy Spirit unction us individually, whether we want to repent of things that we've done in our life or that might not be right, or thank God. A lot of times when I do Yom Kippur and I go through these, I thank God for delivering me from some of the things that He's already forgiven me of. When I think about the blood of Jesus and how He's forgiven me, I don't have to beg for forgiveness and hope Messiah forgives me. But I know that Yeshua has forgiven me, and that I can beg, I can teach the instruction, I can teach the law, right? I can teach the instructions and know that the Holy Spirit will enable us to keep His Torah. And so it's a holy thing. So we're going to take just probably a 10 to 15 minute break, but by 9:30 we'll start off with that portion of it. And I'm going to need a volunteer. Brother Kevin said he wasn't sure if he could stay or not. And we need a volunteer to run the laptop. I've got the link to it. So let us be broke at this time for a short recess, and then we can come back together.